China, Cuba, North Korea, Russia, what do they all have in common? What's the first thing you think about? Dictatorship, civil unrest, communism, or revolution? The Russian Revolution was the turning point for Russian civilization, going from a 300-year-old monarchy which benefited the rich and turn it into a communist society which tried to benefit all and get rid of the societal class structure. The first time the idea of communism was ever implemented into a societal structure. The Russian Revolution after effects had a huge impact on not just Russia, but on other countries like China, Cuba, and North Korea, who are still communist or act communist to this very day, even though the Soviet Union disbanded 27 years ago. Today, I'll take you down the path of history and show you why the Russian Revolution still has a huge impact on today's society. To first understand why the Russian Revolution happened, we need to understand the conditions of the Russian people and their rulers, the Romanovs. The House of Romanov was the second dynasty to rule Russia after the House of Rurik. The royal family and landowners lived a luxurious life while 80% of the population were peasants who worked in dreadful working conditions for long hours with little pay and very high rent. Peasants wanted change, but the royal family denied it, and that pent-up rage would continue to add up for decades to come and lead to the downfall of the royal family. But this was only the start of a series of drastic events. When you start to look at the downfall of the royal family, the moment that kicked it off was Alexander III's death. He died due to a terminal kidney disease and passed on his lineage to his elder son, Nicholas II. Nicholas wasn't ready to become the Tsar. He thought he was going to have more time to prepare, but with his father's unexpected death, he was thrust into a position in which he wasn't ready for. In Tsar Nicholas II's own words, "I'm not ready yet to become the Tsar. I know nothing of the business of ruling." Nevertheless, he accepted his responsibility and became the Tsar. After Nicholas became the Tsar, he was involved in a major conflict 10 years later, the Russo-Japanese War, a war that Russia lost badly. And while it was taking place, one of the most important events that sparked the revolution was about to take place in the heart of Russia. Bloody Sunday. January 22nd, 1905, workers had enough of the suffering, and a group led by a priest Gregory Gapon went unarmed towards the Winter Palace to present a petition to Tsar Nicholas. The petition made clear of the problems and opinions of the workers and called for improved working conditions, fairer wages, and a reduction in the working days to 8 hours. The idea of workers walking up to the Winter Palace is not such an absurd idea, because back then, individual or collective petitions were established means of bringing grievances to the attention of the Tsar's administration, and could be brought to the Tsar directly. When the group approached the gate, they were met by imperial forces who opened fire on them, killing and wounding hundreds. This led to its own revolution for the next few years. The impact from this one event was felt all across Russia. Strikes began to erupt outside of St. Petersburg, like Moscow and Rzhin, and an estimated 414,000 people participated in the work stoppage during 1905. The Tsar tried to appease to the people with the October Manifesto and instated the Duma. Nicholas pledged to introduce basic civil liberties to provide for broad participation in the State Duma, and endowed the Duma with legislative and oversight powers, but Nicholas didn't want to give up his power so easily. So right before the creation of the first Duma in May 1905, the Tsar issued the fundamental laws. It stated that the Tsar's ministers could not be appointed by and were not responsible to the Duma, meaning that they were denied responsible government at an executive level. Also, the Tsar had the power to dismiss the Duma and announce new elections whenever he wanted, basically dismissing any policy he didn't want. He elected the Duma 4 times, once in 1906, twice in 1907, and once in 1912. To say the least, this system wasn't fair and didn't change a single thing, but it did damage the Tsar's reputation majorly and started making him lose his influence. And his reputation would never go up again thanks to one man, Rasputin. Grigory Rasputin was a poor Russian mystic and self-proclaimed holy man who made his way into the royal family, proclaiming he could heal the Tsar and Tsar Zina's sick son, Alexei, from his hemophilia by easing the pain of the boy and stop him from bleeding. Tsarzina Alexandra was convinced that Rasputin could save her son. Rasputin's powers to heal Alexei gave him the status and power in the royal family, the public, and later in the court. As the years went on, Rasputin kept gaining power and using it to its full effect, accepting bribes and attempting to seduce women due to his alleged healing abilities. He became an extremely controversial figure, with people accusing him of rape and religious heresy. By 1911, his behaviors had a horrible reputation, that a report had been made because of his misdeeds. Nicholas expelled Rasputin, but not even a month later, Alexandra had him return, and Nicholas let Rasputin back and ignored any further allegations of Rasputin's misdeeds because he didn't want to displease his wife or endanger his son. Things were really looking bad for the whole country. The people were being ignored, the royal lineage was being corrupted, and the Tsar wasn't helping. It was a bad situation, but before the country had any time to recover, the perfect storm hit, World War I, and things were about to go from bad to worse. World War I was the second nail in the coffin for the rule of the royal family, because before World War I and after the 1905 revolution, the people were suffering to make a living, and now when World War I started, the people were struggling to live. Soldiers were sent out to their deaths, workers still had to work in inhumane working conditions, food shortages were starting to become commonplace, and people were starving, all to support a war that they didn't agree with. On the Romanov side, Nicholas went out to the front lines to command his troops in 1915, leaving Alexandra in charge of Russia's internal affairs while Rasputin served as her personal advisor. Rasputin now had a huge influence over the country, ranging from the appointment of church officials to the selection of the cabinet ministers, who were usually incompetent old men, and he was also involved with military matters from time to time. Everything was looking up for Rasputin. Power, wealth, influence. But on one fateful night, in December of 1916, Rasputin was assassinated. He was killed by a group of nobles who thought his influence over Tsarzina had made him a threat to the empire. He was poisoned, shot 3 times, and died from drowning, finally ending his influence over Alexandra. But at that point, it was too late. People were more unhappy than ever. They were suffering while the Romanov family were making fools of themselves, and that feeling manifested until its breaking point, the March Revolution. On March 4th, 1917, workers in Petersburg's largest factory demanded a 50% wage increase so that they could buy food, but the management refused, so they went on strike. March 8th, more than 30,000 workers were not being paid and couldn't afford any food. The strikers persuaded other workers to go on strike. Demonstrations were now occurring throughout the city, demanding bread and better wages. Nicholas only thought it was the work of hooligans and thought it would end shortly. March 9th, the rioters were getting out of hand, and the Duma pleaded with Nicholas to order the release of emergency food supplies. But he refused and ordered the soldiers that the riots should be stopped by March 10th. March 10th, the soldiers tried to contain the riots, but people got killed, and the rioters got even more furious. It got so out of hand that the soldiers joined the rioters that they were supposed to put down. Nicholas decided the Duma was no longer to meet and left to deal with other problems, but the Duma disobeyed Nicholas. March 11th, the Duma wanted to establish a temporary committee to restore law and order and form the provisional government to take the place of the Tsar. March 12th to the 15th. When Nicholas came back, the army chief, Nikolai, and Duma deputies suggested in unison that he abdicate the throne. At this point, Nicholas was cornered and tried to hand off the throne to others, but he realized it was either a bad idea or they rejected him. It became clear to Nicholas that the provisional government and the people did not want a Tsar, and he was forced to give up the throne. On March 15th, 1917, the Romanov dynasty came to an end after a 300-year-old rule over Russia, now replaced with the provisional government. The provisional government inherited political authority after Nicholas II's abdication. People enjoyed a brief period of hope and optimism for the new provisional government, but that feeling didn't last. The provisional government was immediately confronted by the same policy issues that had destroyed the Tsar. There was still no bread, the bigger working situation was still not being dealt with, and the even more pressing issue was their involvement in World War I. Some argued that they should sign a peace treaty with Germany to ease pressure on its economy and people, and to manage its political reformation, but others argued that they should keep their promise to their allies to keep fighting, and they should honor that. The provisional government chose the latter and continued the fight, a decision that they soon would regret. As the name suggests, the provisional government was only a transitional regime, formed to oversee Russia's transformation from a monarchy to a democratically elected constituent assembly. In the meantime, the provisional government tried to rule like a normal government, but this was a problem. Even though the members were from the Duma, the provisional government had no mandate. It had not been selected or endorsed by the people, so people didn't take their laws and decrees seriously or respected them. Things weren't looking good for the provisional government, and they weren't making the best decisions. The decision to sustain the war effort drove a wedge between the provisional government and the people, and poor war strategies leading into devastating losses. Like Alexander Konerksky's July offensive against the Austro-Hungarians in Gallica in 1917, resulting in 400,000 casualties. Everything was looking bad for the provisional government, but looking good for one man who's been patiently waiting in the shadows, Vladimir Lenin and the Bolsheviks. Vladimir Lenin was a communist revolutionary and political theorist who wanted to change Russia into a communist society based on Karl Marx's theory of Marxism. Karl Marx's theory of Marxism comes from his writings of both the Communist Manifesto, Das Kapital, and his other works about society, economics, and politics, about society's class struggle. Lenin idolized Marx's idea of a classless society and wanted to implement it into Russia and change the Russian regime. In 1893, he was a part of a Marxist revolutionary cell that called themselves the Social Democrats. By 1894, he was leading a Marxist workers' circle and meticulously covered his tracks. He visited many different countries and handed out pamphlets and publications to spread the word of Marxism. Then when he returned to Russia and distributed illegal revolutionary publications to striking workers, he was arrested and charged with sedition. Lenin was imprisoned for a year, and then exiled to eastern Siberia, but this didn't stop him from his goal, and he continued to theorize and write. After his exile, he returned back to Russia and formed a new Marxist party called the Russian Social Democratic Labor Party, or RSDLP. The party was eventually split into two sides, Lenin's supporters, the Bolsheviks, and the other party leader, Julius Martov's supporters, the Mensheviks. The Mensheviks opposed Lenin for being a despotic and autocratic leader, while the Bolsheviks accused them for being opportunists and reformists who lacked discipline. The fighting continued on for many years, until the faction split off in 1912. When the 1905 revolution happened, Lenin urged the Bolsheviks to take a greater role in the events, encouraging violent insurrections. During the 1905 revolution, he met Joseph Stalin, a man who idolized him, and who would soon become a powerful force to mess with. After a series of events, the Tsarist government won the 1905 revolution, and Lenin was once again forced into exile from 1907 to 1917. And the Bolsheviks, without its prominent head, became the minority within the Social Democratic Party, and the Mensheviks became the majority in the Duma under the Tsar rule. Lenin, for the next 12 years, planned to try to get the support of people in changing Russia to a communist country. Events like World War I and the provisional government's unproductive rule of their socialist system helped Lenin's case for his vision of Russia. People started supporting Lenin's ideas for Russia over the provisional governments due to his April thesis, which promised peace, land, and bread. Peace. Exit the war and sign a peace treaty with Germany to stop the fighting. Peasants were to divide up the rural land among themselves, and advocated the forceful dissolution of many wealthy estates by peasant forces. Bread. Give everyone bread to stop the hunger. The amount of support that Lenin got was overwhelmingly positive, and Lenin was finally ready to take action and achieve his goal. The November Revolution is when Lenin showed the world what he was really made of, and that he wasn't just a theorist, but a competent leader and influencer. On November 5th, there was a Bolshevik meeting led by Lenin. At the committee meeting, Lenin discussed how the people of Russia had waited long enough for an armed uprising, and it was the Bolsheviks' time to take power. Lenin expressed his confidence in the success of his plan. His confidence stemmed from months of the Bolsheviks building up their power and successful elections to different committees and councils in major cities such as Petrograd and Moscow. The Bolsheviks created a revolutionary militarized army within Petrograd called the Red Army. Led by Soviet President Leon Trotsky, the Red Army included armed workers, soldiers, and sailors who had their support, and had the neutrality of the capital's garrison in their revolt. The Red Army set up a plan to occupy strategic points within the city to ambush the provisional government. November 6th to 7th, it was time. The Bolsheviks led their forces against Kinerksky's provisional government. The Red Army took control and captured major government facilities, key communication installations, and vantage points with little opposition. The Petrograd garrison and most of the city's military joined in going against the provisional government. The provisional government were essentially sitting ducks and were helpless to oppose them, so they gave up, surrendered, and handed over the government to Lenin and the Bolsheviks, a bloodless victory. Lenin and the Bolsheviks were now finally in power and could run the country however they wanted. They soon got rid of all other parties and formed a new government with Lenin as its head, and he became the dictator of the world's first communist state. This change didn't sit well with some people who were still loyal to the government, or didn't like the direction that the country was going in and opposed the new Bolshevik rule through armed means. And this opposition to this new government sparked one of the most devastating civil wars in history, the Russian Civil War. The Russian Civil War is a whole topic on its own, so I won't go into in depth, but I will tell you the important parts. The Russian Civil War was a multi-party war who fought to determine Russia's political future. The two major factions to note were the Red Army, commanded by the Bolsheviks, and the White Army, an anti-communist group who shared different ideological views, methodologies, and political goals, and acted independently from each other, unlike the Bolsheviks, who had the same ideology and better military coordination. The Tsar and his family were assassinated by the Red Army, to ensure that there was no way that the royal family was ever able to take control over Russia, and to demotivate the factions and take away the little hope that they had. The government implemented the War Communism Act that lasted from the beginning to the end of the Civil War, which banned private trade, took surplus food produced by the peasants to feed the hungry towns and the Red Army, and nationalized all factories and workshops which employed over 10 workers, abolished paper money because uncontrolled inflation rendered them useless near the end of the Civil War, among many other policies. From 1921 to 1922, there was a famine that killed an estimated 5 million people. The war almost lasted 5 years and resulted in 2 million deaths on the battlefield. It was one of the most bloodiest civil wars in history to date. The Bolsheviks won the civil war and asserted their dominance over Russia and gave birth to the Soviet Union. In December 1922, the Soviet Union was officially established and had complete control over the country, with nobody opposing them anymore, and the ones that did started to disappear. Now that they were out of the Civil War, Lenin issued the new economic policy which replaced war communism. The NEP, returned money, agriculture, retail trade, and small-scale light industry to private ownership and management while the state retained control over heavy industry, transport, banking, and foreign trade. This policy helped the Soviet people recover their economy after the many years of war. Also during this time, Lenin made his own version of Marxism called Leninism, which was Russian's application of Marx's economic and political philosophy, but differs from the original. For example, in Marxism, he states a communist revolution will happen because of the gap between the great proletariat and the exploiting capital class. While in Leninism, a communist revolution will happen between the rich countries and the poor countries because the rich countries will want to take advantage of the weak countries, while the poor countries will fight for their freedom. Everything was looking good for Lenin. He finally got what he wanted, after all the pain he went through to get there, only to die 2 years later. Lenin, over the next few years, suffered from illness and multiple strokes that led to his death. He knew that his death was going to come sooner than he thought, so he made notes for whom he thought should lead the Union, and he didn't like his choices. The two most important people to note were Stalin and Trotsky. He viewed them each as the two most gifted leaders among his possible successors, but he didn't like their personalities. Trotsky, to Lenin, was one of the most capable men in the Union, but he also thought Trotsky was cocky. and was overly focused on administrative matters, while he didn't trust Stalin at all because of his willingness to kill for the solution to the problems. After Lenin's death, there was fighting between members for the leading position, and it got swapped around to many different people, but the person who came out on top was Stalin. He did so by manipulating people into fighting each other by supporting them against their opponent, and then turning on them until he was the head of the party. Stalin now had all the power at his fingertips to make his Russia a reality. And it was one brutal reality. But that's a topic for another day. We now have looked back on the Russian Revolution, all the major events that led up to it, what happened during it, and its immediate consequences and effects. But why was it so important? Why did I just spend the past 20 minutes or so talking about it? Well, I'll tell you my own answer that I've come up with during the course of my research. The Russian Revolution was the story of the power struggle between the rich and the poor. And it's something that we should look back on so we can avoid repeating our mistakes, and help us to understand how it influenced other countries to what they are today. Ultimately, the Russian monarchy was the cause of the revolution, and this shows us the problem with the monarchy system. The monarchy system of ruling a country is not fair to 90% of the population, and only benefits the 1% of the population, the ruling royal family. The ruling royal families control all matter of politics and laws, while passing on the rule of the country within the family. The prince or the princess of the ruling royal families didn't need to work for anything to become the ruler of the country. They were just born into it and were taught how to become the ruler, while the rest of the population didn't get that option to rule or change the country since they weren't born into it. At most, they could get the role of a commander or noble in the monarchy if they worked for it, to have some power over their fate in the system, but ultimately, the royal family has all the power. After a while, the monarchy system didn't appease to the masses, and some countries eventually shifted over to capitalism or voted by the people systems, while some countries kept going on with the monarchy system for centuries to come, like Russia. Like stated before, Tsar Nicholas wasn't ready to become the Tsar, but it was his responsibility to uphold the Romanov legacy. So he carried on unprepared to rule his country, and that's what made him make a lot of incompetent decisions since he was unfit for the position. And that's the biggest problem with the monarchy system. If the king or queen are bad at ruling or making decisions, there's not much the people can do to change the king or queen unless they wait for a new one or revolt. We have seen this throughout history. A majority of people are born into a poor or middle-class family life and suffering day in and day out because of their ruler's decisions of ruling the country with no option to change it, while the ruler was born into a position of wealth and fame that they didn't even work for. And that is the reason why the Russian Revolution worked and how communism started to take over. People don't want to feel inferior to others. People don't want to be poor. People want to feel equal. That's why communism resonated with so many Russian people. It was the idea in which everybody was equal in this utopian society where you didn't need to worry about the people abusing you for your worth, and so you could pave a way for a better future. In short, communism gave hope and power to the Russian people, and because of the Russian Revolution, that idea spread to different countries, cultures, and nationalities, and inspired others with its message. Countries today like North Korea, China, and Cuba, even though they aren't true communists, they still use communist ideas in their government. Even though the Soviet Union that inspired or oppressed them fell 27 years ago. It goes to show you that something so self-contained like the Russian Revolution can have huge aftereffects on the world today. For the better, or for the worse.